Hello everyone, welcome to tutorial 57 of our Golang course. In the past few lessons, we have extensively covered packages. In one of these lessons, we explained the underscore import. In this tutorial, we will explore the underscore import, the init function, and their relationship with each other. So, let's dive in. We have previously discussed the use of underscore import in Go. It allows us to import a package solely for its side effects without using any of the exported entities from the package. This is where the init function comes in handy. In Go, there are two reserved functions, the main function, which serves as an entry point for your Go program, and then the init function. Similar to the main function, the init function doesn't accept any argument and doesn't return anything. The init function is called implicitly when the package is imported. So that's where the underscore import comes into play. When you do underscore import, the init function in the package is called automatically. The init function runs before the main function of your package. You can declare multiple init functions in your file, and they will be called in the order of their declaration. If a package has multiple init functions spread across different files, they are called alphabetically based on the file name in which they were declared. Let's now explore the init function with our code examples. So here, I have the main.go file. Let us first initialize our module. So I'm going to do go mod init and provide the module name. For this one, I'm using the module name of init example. Inside our main.go file, we are going to create an init function, funkinit, and then inside it, we will just print a statement. The print statement says, init one called. Now in the main function of our program, let's write another one and say main function call to verify the behavior. And to see how init function is executed, let us run the program. Go run main.go. And as you can see, the init function was called before the main function. Now let me copy this and create multiple init functions. And let's modify this to say init two call and init three call. As I mentioned earlier, you can have multiple init function in a file and they will be called in order of their declaration. So we should expect init1 call first, then init2, init3, and then the main function. Let's run our program and verify the same. And as you can see, init1 call, init2 call, init3 call, and then the main function is called. Now to expand our example, let me create a package called init. Inside it, I will have init.go. Let me name it package init. And here I can say func init and then do fmt println init package init function called. Now let's see the role of underscore import. Here in our imports, I can say import the name of our module and the package. To access the init package, I need to add the directory path. So we are doing an underscore import here. Now let's see what happens when we run our main program. Go run main.go. And as you can see, init function from the init package is called first, and then the init function in the main package are called. So that's basically how you use init with the underscore import. Now, as I told you, you can have multiple init functions spread across different files in your package. Let's create another file, a.go. And inside it, we are still inside package init, func init, fmt, println, init from a call. Now let's again run our program to see how the execution goes. As you can see, init from a is called, and then init package init function is called, followed by the init functions in the main package. As I told you, if inside a package there are multiple init functions spread across different files, Go will use the name of the file in which the init functions are described for execution of init function. So a comes first, then I. That's why you see init from a being called before the init function in the init file. Now if I rename it to say z.go, so that means we are down the hierarchy. Now we would expect the init function in init.go file being called first. Go run main.go. And as you can see, init package init function was called before the init from a called. That's because z is the last one in alphabetical order. So that's how the execution of init function is done by Go. Now let us look at some use cases for init function. The init function is typically utilized to initialize resources such as database connection, caches, or to perform other configuration. It can also be employed to register a package or similar to how you register a database driver. It is also used for side effects. For instance, when a package is imported, initializing of metrics can be done in the init package. So in that way, you can track the usage of that package. This is something that you rarely see, but init function can be used for implementing singleton patterns. Let me now show you a real world example of init function. Here, as you can see, I'm looking at lib/pq package, which is used for Postgres database driver. If you scroll down, you would see the init function is used to register the Postgres driver. So in your own package, when you are using Postgres, you would just import this package with an underscore import, and that way it will automatically call the init function to register the Postgres driver. There are a few things to remember when you're using the init function. The init function runs once per package import, so it will be only executed once. As we have seen, the order of execution can be confusing, and it is not something that can be relied on. For example, if I had a file a.go and had an init function, because I wanted that init function to be executed first, but down the line, someone comes along and renames it to something else. In that way, you cannot rely on the execution of init function. So it is not recommended to use init functions a lot in your code. It should be only used when really, really required. Otherwise, you can just use constructor functions to initialize a global state, which will make your code much clearer. Let's summarize everything we have learned in this lesson. We looked at the init function, which is a special function that is executed before the main function. It does not accept any parameters, just like the main function, and returns nothing, again, just like the main function. As we saw through the real-world example, it is used to initialize entities like registering Postgres database driver. And finally, it should be used with caution, as the order of execution cannot be relied on. That's it for the lesson. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, please feel free to comment under the video or reach out to our Discord server. Until next time, happy coding!